preach, but the last time I preached on this topic, dysfunctional Christians. And so we're just going to quickly review what we talked about. We were just basically talking about how easy it is for us to function dysfunctionally, not just as Christians, but in life itself. And so we gave you three ways we can become dysfunctional, and they were this: that was being dishonest, disengaged, and disoriented. And then we talked about three ways to keep from becoming dysfunctional, which was discipline, diligence, and then dignity. And so, kind of piggybacking off of that, I want to move from that conversation of us being dysfunctional to move into a greater understanding of what we should be doing in our daily walk. We're not just here just to be Christians, to say we're Christians. We actually have a duty and a job, and I want it to be this. We're going to talk about today cultivating culture. Somebody would say that. We say cultivating?
Cultivating.
Culture.
Culture.
Now, it sounds like a wordy title, and as I get into it, it'll make a lot more sense. So we're going to start off by doing some word study. The first thing we do, we're going to look up the word cultivate. And the word cultivate, there's several different definitions, but this one stuck out to me. It says to prepare and develop. It means especially land for crops. In other words, to prepare something for an intended result, to prepare something for a greater result, to prepare something for a harvest. In church, a lot of times we talk about harvest, and we talk about blessing, and we talk about destiny, and we talk about all these good things, and there's nothing wrong with that. All those things are true. They're in the Bible. They're in the scripture. But here it says that there has to be some type of preparation for that. What we want and what we wish, and I kind of alluded to it earlier, we wish that when we walk in the doors of the church, that's all the battle we need. Once we step foot in, all our problems are gone, all our sicknesses are gone, all our money issues are gone. But that's not really how it works. What we do when we come in here, we get energized. But to cultivate, you have to prepare and develop. Prepare and develop. Let me just put it to you this way. Sometimes this life is work. And look at the synonyms for cultivate: to till, to plow, to dig, to hold, to farm, to work, to fertilize. Anybody that has a green thumb, that has a good garden, that has a good lawn, that has anything that is producing well, there was some work involved. My weeds are bad because I'm not good at that. I don't like digging in the ground in the hot sun. I don't like pulling up weeds. But if the garden is going to produce, it's going to require some work. And so let me go to Jeremiah 1 and 5. It says, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nation. I'm setting it up, but just look at your neighbor and say, it's going to get better. It's going to get better. Pastor going somewhere. But just let me set it up and work it just a little bit. And so I love this scripture because it talks about Jeremiah, who was the prophet. It says, before you were formed in the belly, before you are an embryo, before the sperm ever met the egg, before that happened, I already had a destiny for your life. Every one of us, before we were ever born, before our grandma met our granddaddy, before that ever happened, we already have a destiny for our life. And so God told him that you have a destiny for your life. I called you to be a prophet. Not everybody meets the destiny that God has for their life. I would say that almost a overwhelming percent don't ever live up to what God had intended for them. But I don't want that to be said of you. I want you to be what God has created you to be. Next verse we're going to look at, verse 6. Then said I, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. So the first thing Jeremiah said, you probably got the wrong person. I can't even talk. I'll give you an example, and I've shared it before, but I'm reminded of again. The first time that I really heard, not when I was little, I would tell people I wanted to be a preacher and a basketball player. Well, I stopped growing. So basketball, I didn't say I wanted to be a basketball player. I'm talking about NBA. Well, I stopped growing in the sixth grade, so that dream was over. But by then, I didn't really care about preaching anymore. I wanted to do something else. So I thought, I always wanted some money. So I mean, if it wasn't going to be basketball, I want to be a lawyer. So I'm working on things, and so I gave up the idea of being a preacher. That just, I said, forget that. That was something I thought about when I was little because my daddy did it. Forget that. But when I was in college, pursuing the American dream, so to speak, coming down off a tequila binge hangover, head spinning, I heard these words, you're going to speak my word. I'm like, I know I'm drunk. God ain't talking to me. Because I can handle wine cooler, I can handle beer, I even can handle Southern Comfort and Mad Dog 2020. I handled all those well, but that tequila did something to me. That mezcal tequila wore me out, and I wasn't thinking about God, I wasn't thinking about church, I wasn't thinking about Deliverance Temple. I was thinking about the porcelain God where I had thrown up all night long, and I hear these words, one day you're going to preach my word. And here's the thing, God never looks at us for what we presently are in. He looks at us based on what he called us to be.
All right.
Let me see how I can break it down. When the Mercedes factory, when they made a Mercedes, they made it to do certain things. So if you are standing, jumping up on top of the Mercedes, using it for what it was not intended, it doesn't affect the manufacturer. The manufacturer would still try to manufacture another Mercedes. Just because it was used improperly doesn't mean the manufacturer is going to stop trying to produce what it wants to produce. Just because somebody in your family walked away from God, just because somebody you know became an alcoholic, just because somebody gave up on a marriage, that does not mean that you can't rise up and be the new breed and start something brand new and start something different. Because God has a plan for your life, and once you get in line with his plan for your life, you begin to understand that things begin to work positively for you. It's not easy to get in his will. It's easier to get out of his will than it is to get in his will. But once you get in his will, you'll find out that he begins to work with you, and you'll find out, God, what you have for me is much better than what I have for me. Once I accept it, okay, I'll give up. I'm going to go ahead and preach. My life changed for the better. But let me move on even further. Let's go to the next verse. It says this, Jeremiah 1:7. But the Lord said unto me, say not, I am a child. For thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. God told Jeremiah, don't worry about what you're not. Don't even talk about what you're not. Don't even talk about your issues. Well, Pastor, I'm addicted to this. God said, don't even focus on the negative. What I want you to understand is what I commanded you, you're going to have the power to speak it. Next verse says this, verse 8. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Let me pause real quick and say this. What hinders most of us from doing what God wants us to do is we're so concerned what somebody else is going to think. I can't because so-and-so knows what I've done. Here's the thing. God knows what you've done, and God said, I'm going to use you. So what you got to do, you got to line up with what God says and stop worrying about what your friends say, what your family say. If they don't put breath in your body, you don't have time to give them that much attention. Don't let somebody who does not give breath to you control your life.
Amen.
Some of you would be much farther ahead if you stop looking at people around you. Well, I can't go to church. Why can't you go to church? Well, I still drink. Well, you ain't the only one. Come on to the house of God. Come on. We think there's a place for you. But what will the people think? Who cares what they would think? Why would you do what's best for you? So he said, don't worry. Don't be afraid of their faces. Next verse, 9. Then the Lord put forth his hand. This is what I love. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. God is not concerned about what you're not because he has the power to touch your mouth. When you want to go tell somebody about the goodness of God, the first thing the devil will tell you, well, you ain't that great, so you don't need to be talking. You should probably be quiet. You don't need to be inviting people to church because you're not special. You cuss and you do this. But you have to understand, once God touches your mouth, I don't care the trouble you have. I don't care the struggles you have. Once God touches your mouth, he empowers you to do what you couldn't do unless he touched your mouth. The reason why I do what I do is not because of what I know, it's because of who touched. He touched my mouth. And since he touched my mouth, I had power. The next part says, and the Lord said to me, behold, I have put my words in your mouth. Not only have I touched your mouth, I put my words in your mouth. In other words, I'm making it easier for you. I'm making it easier for you to tell people about me. I'm going to give you my words. You really want to know, it's difficult to stand up here and do what I do, but it's easy in the sense that I don't have to come up with words. The words are already there. All I got to do is take them out and talk about them because God gave me what to say. And where we're going, what I'm trying to show you is that you are going to be the mouthpiece for God next. Not just me. My job is to stir you up to go out and tell somebody else and tell them. And the first thing people say, well, I'm not all that. I know you're not all that, but you have God's words.
Amen.
All right. Next verse says this. This is the last part of this verse before we're going to move off of the cultivate. It says this, Jeremiah 1:10, see, I have this day set thee over nations. Now, Jeremiah says, I'm a child. And God says, I put you over nations. Now, what I want you to understand, what you see in the mirror is not what God sees. What you see in the mirror, well, I'm from Crosstown, I'm from White Bay, I'm from this, I'm from that. God says, I put you over nations. Because you have more power than what you understand. And so the next part says this, I put you over nations and over kingdoms to root out and to pull down.
Yeah.
And to destroy, and to throw down, to build, and to plant. I'm going to read it again. To root out, and to pull down, and to destroy, and to throw down. And then it says to build and to plant. Now this is what I want you to understand, that most of the times once we come to God and we get in God and we're doing the things of God, we're coming to church and you know our life is kind of working out, we still find a lot of issues. Like I said, sometimes we want those issues to go away, but what we don't understand is that God put us in the earth not just to have easy street, but he put us in the earth to work. He put us in the earth to root out. He put us in the earth to pull down. He put us in the earth to destroy and to throw down, and then he wants us to build and plant. We want to build and plant right away, but sometimes there's some stuff that needs to be torn down. How can I put it to you? Let me give you this example. There are people that we don't understand, and those of us who have sane minds don't understand. But there are people walking around this earth now, happens all the time in almost every city, and I don't understand it. People walking around right now that get pleasure of having sexual relations with little kids. I don't understand it. Craziest thing I've ever heard, but it's in the land. People are getting locked up for it all the time. Folk teaching people, coaches, priests, it's happening all the time. And we as the body of Christ, we don't know where it is, but it's our job to root out.
Yes.
It's our job to pull down. Yes. It's our job to destroy some stuff. So what I do, whenever I pray for a baby, whenever I begin to anoint them and curse them, I curse the molester's hand. I don't know who he is. I don't know where she is, but I curse it. Because it's my job to pull down. It's my job to root out. It's my job to destroy. It's my job to throw down. Why? Because God's put his words in my mouth. You're more powerful than you know. You're greater than what you know. Your prayers are doing more than what you know. When you look at the news, don't just look at the news and say, oh, wow, that's a shame. And then you get on the phone and say, you see what they're doing in Indianapolis? You see what's going on in the first? No, begin to pray. Begin to open up your mouth because it's your job to root out, to pull down, to destroy something. And you know what? The reason why the world is so bad is because the church is so lazy. We just want to come in here and get our fix so we can feel better and go about our week. There's nothing wrong with that, but sometime through the week, you got to get to work. You got to get to cultivate. It's your job. When you see something wrong, you need to do something about it. Say something about it. Rise up. Try. I don't know what to do, but I'm trying everything I know how. Some of y'all seen that I rode with the cop on Wednesday in the cop car riding. I want to know, before I criticize the cops, I want to know what they have to go through. So when an opportunity came open, I got in there and I rode with them. And on every call, on every place we went, and everything that happened, what I was doing, I was praying. I'm doing my job. It's not my job to arrest people. It's not my job to put handcuffs on people. people, it's not my job to try to figure out everything that's going on, but I can pray. So every time the lights went on, I'm in that prayer. Every time something happens, I'm praying because I'm trying to make a difference, and I'm just crazy enough to believe that little old me can make a difference.
Yes, yes.
Why? Because he's put his words in my mouth.
Amen.
And you'll say, well, that's the pastor's job. No, it's not the pastor's job. It's all of our job. Do what you can to cultivate culture.
Yes,
amen.
Amen. Let's go to culture. Actually, before I get to culture, that cultivating, that pulling, rooting out, there's so many ways you can do it. I'll give you an example. One time in our pastor's meeting, they were getting ready to have the Black Expo. And a couple of previous years, every time they were shooting out at Heaton Park. So what we did quietly, we didn't tell anybody what we're doing, we didn't put it on Facebook. I get bothered at preachers that always got to tell everybody what they're doing. You don't always have to say it. But what we did, we took shifts as pastors, and we walked around Heaton Park a couple days before the expo, and we began to pray. No more bullets, no more shootings. Now we don't know if we're going to make a difference, but we're going to try. Because we are somebody in the earth. Stop saying, oh, woe is me. Oh, Muncie's so bad. Oh, I got to get out of. What are you doing to make a difference? And if it's nothing but prayer, guess what? Prayer changes things. Do your part.
Yes.
Get out there and do your part. Sometimes go to the hospital and just walk through the halls and just pray, because it's our job to root out, to pull down, to destroy. Yeah. Because we can't plant and build if we haven't first cultivated.
Amen.
Let's go with culture. Culture is the customary beliefs, social forms, and material traits of a racial, religious, or social group. Also, the characteristic features of everyday existence shared by people in a place or time. And the two examples are pop culture, or what they call popular culture, or southern culture. In other words, what culture is almost silent. It moves on without anybody knowing about it. It's just the way things are done. In other words, the southern culture, if you go down south, it is high in racism, but it's also high in southern hospitality. It's just the culture. It's just the norm. It's what we do. And it's okay if the norm and the culture and the idea is good. That's okay. But when it's bad, you can't just allow the culture to dictate to you how you're going to live. So, for example, Muncie, the culture of Muncie is just, oh, well, oh, well. Just like, you know, whatever will be. If I get it done, I get it done. If I don't, I don't. No, no, no hope, no goals, no dreams. So we can easily sit within the culture, or we can decide, no, we're going to cultivate our own culture. I'm not doing what everybody else is doing. I'm not doing it. Well, this is what we're supposed to listen to. You're young, you're Black, you're supposed to listen to that. Well, I don't like it. I'm not listening to what everybody else listens to. I'm my own person. I'm going to be my own man. You got to make up in your mind, I will not let somebody else dictate to me what I'm supposed to be.
Yes, Lord.
If you get enough money to move out the hood, people talk about you. Why are you leaving the hood? Why are you paying my bills? Well, shut up. I'm going to do what makes me happy. I do not have to fit the social norms of somebody else. I can do my own thing. When I decided to write a book, I had nobody around me that had ever wrote a book, but I made up in my mind, I'm going to write a book because I will not let somebody tell me what I'm supposed to be.
Yes, Lord.
Well, you know, if you're going to make it, it must, you got to sell drugs. The devil is a liar. I'm going to do it another way. I will not let the culture tell me what I have to be.
Amen.
And we got to pull down the ideas. And if you're a young girl, well, nobody's going to like you unless you wear a mini skirt up to here. Listen, why don't you just do your own thing?
Yes, Lord.
Try to do something different. Nobody that was done anything great did it by following the crowd. You got to make up in your mind, I'm just going to be different.
Yeah.
I'm going to be different from the culture, especially when the culture is bad.
Amen.
When the culture is negative, I'm going to rise above the culture. The first part of this definition says the customary beliefs. In other words, it's what everybody believes without even challenging it. This is what we believe. This is what we're supposed to do in the summertime. We're supposed to go to the Soul Bowls and the Expos, and that's all we're going to do. Well, no, I'm going to take a cruise. I don't want to just watch somebody play basketball all summer. I want something different. I want to go to Hawaii. I don't want to do what I've always done.
Yes, Lord.
But sometimes we're just like trained puppies. We're just following. And if we're going to death, we'll just follow. This is what you're supposed to do. No, I'm going to be different.
Amen.
And if your pastor is different, you got to be different too.
That's right.
You got to make up in your mind, because it's easy to be just like everybody else.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you know what?
Yeah.
The only way that you can keep a woman, you got to punch her every now and then to let her know who's boss.
Yeah.
My uncle may have done that. My grandpa may have done that. But I'm not doing it. I'm not going to do what everybody else has done. And this is what bothers me. People who are nowhere in life have the most advice on what you should do.
Amen.
Yeah, you hit your wife and she got six other men. I don't want a relationship like you have. I want something better.
Amen.
I want something different. If you're a young girl, you shouldn't want to visit your boyfriend behind bars.
Amen.
But every time we go out, he pays the bill. Yeah, but he's using messed up money. You ought to want something different.
Amen.
We make the devil's job easy because he doesn't have to do new things for us. He just throws out the old trap and we walk right in. I'm tired of walking into the old traps. So I want to cultivate a new culture. So let's look at a verse that I have here. Well, not a verse. I'm going to make a couple statements. This statement here I want to put up. Too many churches have created cults when they should have been creating a culture. So we know the culture outside sometimes is negative. So instead of the church creating a positive culture outside, we just come in the building and we have our own cult. We do our own thing. We have our own rules. Rules that people don't understand. Where women can't wear makeup. Women gotta have a long pant. A long dress. Nobody understands that, because instead of us creating a culture and making a difference out there, we come inside the church and have these little, basically, country clubs. A lot of churches are nothing but a bunch of country clubs where all your friends get together and have a nice little time. That does not change the world one iota. I don't want a cult. I want a brand new culture.
Amen.
So our job is not just to come in here on Sunday, dress up, and shake hands and hug people and listen to some music and go on out and just live the same way day in and day out. No, we ought to be making a difference.
Amen.
Too many churches are just a bunch of cults.
Amen.
And it's some of the craziest stuff that you ever want to see has happened in churches. The fact that Jim Jones got a whole bunch of people to drink cyanide, talking about God's going to do something, and they all died. That happened under the banner of Christianity. And Jim Jones came from Richmond, Indiana, and started something good and something great, and then it got off and got twisted and got crazy, and here you are, you end up in a cult. You should never be a part of a cult. You should always know in your spirit something's wrong.
Amen.
I love Pastor Andre, but he's wrong on this. I'm sorry. He wrong about this. What do you mean? He can have my wife. Something wrong with him if he thinks he can do that. You should never get stuck in a cult because you're trying to get away from the culture. Basically what I'm saying, what we've done instead of affecting the culture, we try to run away from the culture and make our own thing. And that's how folks end up getting crazy. You're so spiritual that you can't talk to your neighbor. Well, you know they smoke. So what? You can talk to somebody that smokes. You can talk to somebody that drinks. You can actually go in a bar and minister to somebody. You don't have to act like you're in some hidden place. You can be normal and still be different.
Amen.
Let me say it again. You can be normal and still be different.
Amen.
The problem is, church will go from one extreme to the other. I don't want to be like the world, so now I can't do anything. Can't go to the park because it cuts at the park. But you watch HBO and it cuts all day on HBO, but you can't go to the park. Stop being silly and sinitty. Just be yourself, but understand this. God has touched your mouth. And so when you go out in the world, you make a difference, and you don't have to be all crazy and spooky to do. I got to get off of this. But sometimes church people bother me the most. And I'm not talking about y'all, but I'm talking about people who just get all deep. Sometimes I don't want to be called pastor. Sometimes I just want to be called Andre. Well, doing? Just call me Andre. You ain't got to be all deep. It's Saturday morning at 9 o'clock a.m. I don't want to be all bishop and apostle. Just call me Andre.
Amen.
Because when I go down to the place where my birth certificate is, they don't ask for Pastor Mitchell. They say, where's Andre? I want Andre Mitchell. Sometimes we need to take our titles off and all our extra off and just be regular, real people, but still be different.
Amen.
What people enjoy about me is that I'm relatable. I know how to relate and still be different.
Amen.
When Jay-Z's album dropped 444, I wanted to hear it. So I decided to listen to a Christian ask me, it's like, is that a poor witness that people know you're listening to rap? I'm not listening to Jay-Z's album every single day of the week. I only listen to it once, but I listen to it because I want to know what the people out there are listening to. How can I reach them if I'm always separate from them? I got to know what's going on. Now, it doesn't mean I get moved like everybody else gets moved. I don't mind going to a club, but I'm not a clubber. That's not who I am. I'm sane. I don't want to go and shake my butt every weekend, but every now and then I want to walk in the club to let people know in the club that I'm not too good to be with you. I can get down with you and still be separate from you because God has touched my mouth. All right.
Amen.
Next thing. Too many churches criticize the culture without creating the culture that's a viable alternative. You criticize people for doing what they do, but you don't give them something that's a good alternative, because when they come to church, all they get is condemnation, judgment, mean looks, and foot whispering. You see the pastor's daughter? You see the pastor Jill? She got some babies out of wedlock. People don't want to come to a church like that.
Amen.
Don't criticize someone if you can't offer them something better.
Amen.
And what I want us to do, I want us to stand up and be critical of the culture, but also offer something better.
Amen.
Let's go back to the example of the molestation of kids. I criticize that. Like, I stand against that. Now, actually, by law, if I find out what's going on, I'm required by law to go and say something and do something about it.
Yeah.
But what can happen is the kids can be taken away from the mother. They can go into foster homes. They can go into all kinds of stuff. We cannot shine a light on a problem and then just walk away. Because sometimes when you shine a light on the problem, people get in the system. We have to go and follow up and be willing to do whatever we can. I did not get a house so I can get some other kids in the house. I bought a house for me and my kids, but if push comes to shove, if a child is going to be molested and there's nowhere else to go, I'm going to step up and say me and Devin would help do whatever we got to do, because I want to make a difference.
Amen.
Amen.
Some of us want to make a difference until it costs us.
Uh-huh.
I want to make a difference, but I don't feel like doing all that. You learn that when you deal with people who are actually really, really addicted. They will get on your last nerves, because they always want to come to you when they don't run out of their money. When things are going good, they're fine. But I found out when you step in and say you're going to help somebody, it's not always going to be easy. But I will never criticize somebody if I'm not going to offer them something else. What I believe nobody should walk away from you unless you've done everything you know you can to put them in a better position.
Amen.
So don't criticize. This is what's really we're bad about. We criticize the homosexuals, but we haven't shown them what real love looks like. They say, well, you're over there loving men, and you're over there loving women, women with men, God be great, Adam and Steve. We got a whole bunch of stuff we say. But have you shown them an alternative? Do you have any good relationships? You want your 12th boyfriend, 13th girlfriend, but you want to talk about the homosexual. Why don't you shut up? Because you don't have a viable alternative.
Amen. Amen.
You can't criticize people unless we have a viable alternative. I don't want to stay on this too long, but the Bible says, it says, strong drinker for those who have a heavy heart. It says that the reason why people end up drinking and drinking their sorrows away because they have a heavy heart. So the church should be an alternative. People come in here, they should be blessed. But sometimes people come to the church and they're so bored because the service is so dry, it's so dead, and people leave here and I think, you know what, I'll leave church. I don't need a drink after listening to that mess. Leave me a good shot because we're not a good alternative. We don't mind criticizing. Hey, y'all need to get out. church, you don't have nothing going on. Toilets don't work. Air's not working. And you saying, come. Well, at least when I go to the club, the air works. And the music is good. But we don't want to criticize people, but we don't want to have the alternative. That's why I'm trying to build us to be an alternative. I know we don't have everything right, but I'm trying to work so that we look like we've got something to offer people when they come in the doors. I don't want to have the raggedest church in Muncie. How can I tell you to get out of a place if I can't offer you something that's at least on par with what I'm telling you to come out of?
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, and young people will test you because they're like, I ain't coming to y'all church. And another thing, when I go to the club, I know how long I'm going to be there. When I go to your church, I don't know when we're going to get out. You just going to talk and talk and talk. They just like until you will go. When is your church get out? I don't know. I had a friend of mine who was teasing another friend. He said, man, y'all get out of church on Monday. Y'all start Sunday morning and y'all don't get out of church until Monday. There's nothing wrong with being in the house of God, but nobody wants their time wasted. And until the church has a real good alternative, we need to keep our mouths shut about what other people are doing. All right. Now, this is what we really need to be doing. I'm going to try to speed this up. What we should be doing is creating a subculture. What a subculture is, it's a cultural group within a larger culture, often having beliefs or interests at variance with those of the larger culture. In other words, we are a culture within the culture, but our beliefs are different than the larger culture. Let me give you an example. All of us in here, I think, today are black people. And so blacks have a certain culture. And sometimes we have to learn how to rise above the culture. It's so bad that even white people will say CP time. I'm on CP time today. Because they're so used to our culture being late in everything we do. But we got to have a subculture and say, even though I'm black, I will not be late. I will not do what everybody has always done. I'm creating a culture underneath the culture that has different ideas and that will do things different. It's not that we are ashamed of our culture, but we're willing to say, even within our culture, there's some stuff that needs to change.
Man.
And what I'm saying as a black preacher, and what I wish my white preachers would say the same thing, is that I wish my white preachers would talk about the racism that goes on in the land. Some of my white friends, they act like it's not going on. They don't want to challenge the culture. Yeah. But I want us to be a culture above the culture, be different, be in it, be separated, be in it, be different, be loving, be acceptable, but always be on another level.
Amen.
When people approach you, they ought to know you're approachable, but you're always on another level. You ought to think on another level. When somebody has a conversation with you, they should leave the conversation saying, man, there's something about that fella, something about that girl. She's different. In other words, you are subculture. You're in the culture, but you're different. Give me a quick example. A submarine is something that goes into the ocean or the sea, but it goes down below. And it's able to sometimes come under the enemy and pop up on the other side. I want to be that type that we go down below. We dig deep. And when the devil is looking for us, he can't find us because we're deep enough. We're not on the surface level. We're deep, and then we pop up ready to do something special.
Amen.
So what we're cultivating a subculture. All right. A good way to put this out is Hosea 10 and 12. Excuse me. It says this: sow yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy, break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain righteousness upon you. In other words, what I'm saying is we got to break some stuff up so that we can grow to the place that we need to be, that we're a culture within a culture that's different than the culture that still affects the culture. So how do you do that? The first thing you got to do is you got to cultivate. You got to dig. You got to break up some stuff. And I'm not talking about here on Sunday morning. I'm talking about by yourself. There's some stuff in you that ain't no good that you got to work on. We all have some issues, but instead of us just hiding our issues and trying to pretend, that's what a lot of church people do. They just try to pretend like they don't have it. No, don't pretend. Be honest and start working on it. Break up your fallow ground so God can come and rain righteousness on you. In other words, God wants to bless you, but he really doesn't like to bless mess. He will bless mess sometimes just because he loves you, but he'd rather you put yourself in a position where you can receive his blessings. So what you got to do? You got to break up some stuff. You got to work on some stuff. You've got to be honest with yourself. If every time somebody cuts you off in traffic, you lose your head, you got to be honest. You're not as saved as you think you are. And some stuff that needs to be broken up.
Amen.
If you cannot talk about race relations without wanting to kill somebody of the opposite race, you still got some issues. You gotta work on it. It doesn't make you bad, but be honest with God. Say, God, there's some stuff that sometimes I'm pretty good with race relations, but sometimes I wake up and I don't want to be bothered with white folk. That's not a good spirit to have. I can't walk around like that, because some people say there's something called reverse racism. There's no such thing as reverse racism. Racism is racism flat out. If it's black versus white, even though we may feel like we have a right, wrong still wrong. So sometimes I gotta be honest. I don't know where that comes from. But every now and then, that spirit wants to rise up in me. And we all have things that we have to break up. Every now and then, let me put this this way. Every now and then, I want to see, do I still have it? What do you mean, Pastor? In other words, I'm married, but every now and then, something in me says, look that girl's way to see if you still have it. No, I'm going to focus on what God has told me to do. But if I relax, old stuff becomes brand new again. Wherever you are in life, wherever you are in your Christian walk, you will always have something you're going to need to break up. Maybe anger. It may be lust. It may be laziness. There's always something you have to work on. And here's the thing. If I, as your pastor, as your leader, if I'm always working, you ought to be working too.
Amen.
Bringing things up.
Amen.
Next verse says this. 10:13. It says, ye have plowed wickedness, ye have reaped iniquity. The problem is, even in the church, is that we've sown too much junk. And even though we want God to bless us, we got a whole bunch of junk still out there. Now here's the thing. God saves us from our sins. He saves us from our sins past, present, and future. If you're saved, you're going to heaven. Even if you have sins, you're going to heaven, because God washes all your sins, but sins have consequences.
Amen.
So we think, oh, just because I'm going to heaven, then I can do whatever I want because God saved me. That's not what it means. The Bible says you can do whatever you want, but everything you want is not expedient. It's not beneficial. In other words, if I want to right now, I can go and rob a bank and still be saved. But that don't mean I won't get locked up. Consequences will still follow you. Sometimes we in church, we think salvation means that we won't get consequences. And the problem, the reason why we're in the mess that we are in, is because we sowed a bunch of junk that has to come back, because you will reap what you sow. Pastor, I don't know why God won't bless me. Well, let me tell you why God won't bless you, because you gossip about everybody in the city. How could God bless you like that? He wants to bless you, but you got too much junk out there.
Right.
And we got to start being honest. You know what, God? I got some junk that I need you to clean up. I'm going to do my best. Don't just be lazy. Say, God, I know I shouldn't have said that. I know I shouldn't have done that. I know I'm still saved, but God, I want to be the best version of myself I can possibly be. So, God, help me.
Yeah, my God.
Sometimes my biggest prayer is, help me, God.
Yeah.
I don't want to think like that. I don't want to act like that.
Yeah.
I don't want to feel this way. God, help me. And I notice when I'm honest with God, God always makes me better than I was before.
Amen.
But because I'm in the field I'm in, I've met too many people at the top, too many pastors that are just, they're not even trying to live right. Because they got people fooled, so they're just doing all kinds of stuff. I don't want to be that type of person. I don't want to fool people and be living a raggedy life, because consequences are going to come.
Yeah.
Amen.
All right. Don't think when I preach grace that I'm saying you're not going to have any consequences. I can go down right now and I can smack Sharika right now. But there may be consequences. She might pull out a gun and shoot me. That's a consequence of what I did. Just because God has forgiven you doesn't mean you should do anything that comes to your mind.
That's right. Amen.
All right. Let's go this way. I'm trying to give you a few things that needs to be broken up. And then we're going to try to, I'm going to try to close from here. Got about 20 minutes left. I'm trying to get down early. But, so I'm saying we got to break things up. Let me give you a few things that need to be broken up. What needs to be broken up? Number one we're going to talk about is carelessness. Carelessness needs to be broken up. That's one of the spirits that governs us. It's just that careless spirit. That's got to be broken up. So what does the scripture say about that? Let's look at Ephesians 5:17. It says, don't live carelessly, unthinkingly. Make sure you understand what the master wants. The reason why sometimes we don't have financial blessings is because we're careless with the way we spend our money. And the way we spend our money is a test of how much God can bring to us. And you're wondering, like, you know what? God will never bring me out. God will never do more for me. Because every time you get some money, you run to Honey Cuts and eat $10 worth of ice cream every day. You don't put anything back. You don't save anything. You're just careless. And so what God says, I want to bless you, but you're too careless. You don't think things through. You say things without thinking. You do things without thinking. I love you. I want to help you, but you're too careless. We've got to stop being careless, because carelessness will hurt you.
Yes, it will.
You know what? One thing that I've learned that I've been struggling with is I hate dealing with customer service. But customer service is horrible nowadays. And so what I should do when I call someone and I hear them, they say, this is John from AT&T. I should write down, this is John from AT&T. Because John promised me something, and then it doesn't come through. And then I got to call AT&T and back and say, where is such and such? And why didn't it happen? And they were like, we never promised it to you. And I'm like, yeah, you promised it to me, but I can't remember who I talked to. So now I'm learning, whenever I call some customer service, I'm taking notes. What's your name? What did you say you were going to do for me? What time did you say you were going to do it? Because I'm not trying to be so careless. The reason why I didn't take notes before, because I didn't feel like I had time, but I've been burnt too many times. Been sitting at home waiting from 9 to 12 when they say they're going to be there, wasting my time, and they don't show up. And I call back, where you are? Where are you? Well, we're not supposed to be there. Yes, you are. Who'd you talk to? Guess what, Andre, you're too careless. I'm going to change things. If we learn to be more diligent about our life, we can go a lot farther. Like, rich people are not rich on accident. Rich people pay attention to details. Now, I don't want to talk about him, but as crazy as I think he is, there's something about Donald Trump that got him where he is now. The fact that he was able to go from never being in office to being the president, he knows something. I don't really like him, and I'm not really happy with my president, but I can't knock everything he did because he's sitting somewhere that I never could sit. Because he knows something. What Donald Trump does know, he knows about marketing. He knows how to create a story. He knows how to have all eyes on him. And while everybody was running the regular campaign, he comes out talking about Mexicans are crazy. He comes out talking crazy, and he got all the attention. He got all the press, and next thing you know, we surprised when he's sitting in the office because he knew what he knew. Even though I'm not crazy about him, he wasn't careless in what he did. But now that he's in the office, we're seeing some of his carelessness because he occupied something he wasn't ready for. But just understand the principle. If you know how to do something well and you're not careless about it and you think it through, you can occupy spaces that people say you never could occupy.
Amen.
Verse 15 says this. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise. Sister Ruthie, when she preached her message last month, she talked about preparation and the difference between wise and foolish. It's not that you're not saved, sometimes you're unwise. And sometimes Christians are the most unwise. We think we can just speak in tongues and all our problems go away. That don't do nothing. You need to be wise and do what you need to do. Let me throw this out there. You parents, if your child is in second grade, and all they kindergarten, and all they're doing is shapes and colors and sizes, if they're flunking kindergarten, and you let that go on, don't be surprised when they get 15 and you gotta kick them out of your house because they can't get a job and they don't know nothing. You let stuff go on too long. If Johnny cannot tell the difference between a square and a circle, you need to be the first one down to the school saying, can my child have some help? But you know what our parents do? They're always picking on my boy. No, your boy is dumb. That's the problem. You need some help. Don't be unwise.
Amen.
Well, we're going to pray. We're going to pray for my dad. I'll never forget my mom. I think she may have just came. came in, but she sent me down. I was just sometimes lazy. I know you can't believe it, but sometimes I was lazy. So I was getting bad grades, and my mom sent me down to the altar. So back then, you got sent down to the altar. There were two things you did. They beat you at home, and they sent you to the altar rail. So she got tired of beating me on my grades, so she sent me down to the altar, and she said, tell him, when he asks you what you want, tell him your grades. So I went down there, and the man, the preacher, used me out of town. He said, what do you want? I said, my grades. He grabbed my head. He said, I will give my grade headaches. And he thought I said my grades. Prayed 10 minutes over my grades, and I was really going for my grades. But prayer doesn't do everything. Some stuff you just gotta do on your own. Now, I will say I've never had a migraine in my life, so maybe the prayer worked. But at the end of the day, I had to learn how to be a better student. And we have to be practical. We can be spiritual, but we have to be practical too. Don't live unwise, be wise. All right, Ephesians 5:16 says this. I love this. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. God is not obligated to give you a second chance at an opportunity. Because he's good, sometimes he will, but the days are getting evil. And when a chance and an opportunity comes, you got to learn how to take the opportunity. Make the most out of every opportunity. And that's what I'm talking about, even with kids in school. People are going to college and getting master's degrees and cannot find a job and don't have skills. You got to make the most of every opportunity. When you can, parent, go to the school, find out all the help you can need, because if today is evil, if God tears is coming 10 years from now, 15 years from now, how bad do you think it will be then? We got to make the most out of every opportunity we can.
Amen. Amen.
That includes things like vacation Bible school. Make the most of the opportunity. My child is just bad. I think he's the devil. But you don't bring him to church. I mean, make the most of every opportunity. All right, the next thing that we need to break is carnality. Somebody say carnality. 1 Corinthians 3:1 says, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. You're saved, but you still have a baby mentality. Verse 2 says, I have fed you with milk and not with meat. For hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able. He said this. He said, you handicapped me because I wanted to feed you meat, but I had to keep feeding you milk. That's why, and I don't knock everybody, but that's why some churches, all they want to do is shout. Be happy. It's milk. You need more than that to make your marriage work.
Amen.
You need more than just a drum and an organ and God will do it. You need more than that. You need some meat. And in God, there's really only two levels. There's milk or meat. And you can be in church 30 years and still be on milk.
Yeah.
So we got to break up. And we have the Bible says we have to desire the sincere meat of the word, or the milk of the word that produces the meat. We should always want to grow and be on a higher level. Yeah. So that's why, even though I can preach those type of messages, I rarely preach them here, because I want us to grow. I want us to be at our highest level. And so that's why I take time to teach.
Amen.
Because I want us to go somewhere. All right, the next verse says this. For ye are yet carnal, for whereas there's among you, he said, this is how I know you're carnal. Whereas among you there's envy, there's strife, there's divisions. Are ye not carnal and walk as men? Some of the biggest churches have been split over this stupid stuff. People doing great ministry, but they got split over soft, small stuff, because humans are humans, but sometimes humans are too carnal. You know what? I'm leaving your church, Pastor. Why? So-and-so sat in my seat 2 weeks in a row. Let me look under the chair. Is your name on it? I didn't know your name was on the chair. We let the stupidest stuff stop us from being blessed. And Paul told him, he said, I know you're carnal because you got too much junk going on. And when a church has a whole bunch of junk going on, they're nothing but a bunch of carnal people. I don't care how much you preach and how much you give, they won't go far. Amen. Let me get off of that. I'm going to go to Romans 8:6. It says this, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Verse 7 says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Verse 8 says this, so then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. We love God, but the only way we can please God is we have to have a change of our thinking.
Yes.
I don't care how many times you come in here and preach, your thinking has to change. And you have to walk in faith because without faith it's impossible to please God. So we have to let go of our carelessness, we have to let go of our carnality. Let me give you some things that need to be cultivated in this place. So we break up carelessness, break up carnality. Here's some things that need to be cultivated in this place. Number one, cooperation. Say cooperation.
Cooperation.
Another reason why churches fail is because people won't cooperate. The reason why cities fail is because churches won't cooperate. If I get depressed, the church down the street is mad and they fight. And that's been going on for years, especially in black churches, where we should be coming together. Now, Muncie, we've done a lot better. A lot of our churches are coming together. But for years, you couldn't get anything done because people just wouldn't cooperate. And that happens, all of that happens in families. Family will be further along, but people won't cooperate. Cooperation is so simple, it's so key. Some of y'all know your job would be further along if people would cooperate. People just always fight. It's always a bunch of junk. The reason why we have to have one high school, the reason why money is missing, because folk in Muncie don't know how to cooperate. God is forcing us together, saying y'all can't be the same all your life. You have to cooperate. But look what the scripture says. The scripture says in Psalms 133 and 1, it says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, and went down to the skirts of his garment. I'll say this real quick. He was a high priest, and when they would anoint the head, and it went down the beard, it went all the way down, all the way to the bottom of his robe, the bottom of his garment. It meant everything got blessed. All God had to do was to bless the head, and everything got blessed because Aaron's head was not here and his shoulder there, his leg there. If he was dismembered, he would have been dead. He was put together. But the problem is because of the body of Christ, but the head is over here, the arm is over here, the ankle is over here, and we wonder why we can't all get blessed, because God can't get us all to work together so he can bless us all at one time.
Amen.
All right, and the next verse says this. I know it's tight, but it still is right. Psalm 143, as the dew of Hermon, as the dew that descended upon the mountain of Zion, this is going to prove what I just told you. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. There's some blessings that God has commanded. And when God commands a blessing, it stays out there till the job gets done. But guess what? Some people end up in the casket before they ever get the blessing because they won't cooperate. After cooperation, there is corroboration. Somebody say corroboration. Explain this to you really quick. Only got a few minutes. Corroboration. When police and investigators are investigating a crime, and they have someone, and the person has an alibi. So they say that there was a robbery on the gallery, and the vehicle matches your vehicle, Andre Mitchell. It happened Sunday, July 16th at 12:30. Somebody else can corroborate my story, and I say no. Sunday, July 16th at 12:30, I was in the pulpit preaching, and you guys can corroborate because you can tell them the same thing that I'm telling. You can let them know my alibi is true because you corroborate my story. You understand that? That if there's a witness that can corroborate, a lot of times people get off. And so what do I mean by corroborate? What I mean is that I'm up here preaching the word of God, and I'm up here being positive every Sunday. I need you to corroborate what I'm saying. Don't walk out here and be negative. If I'm preaching blessing, don't walk in here talking about the curse. If I'm saying your marriage is going to work out, don't walk out here and say, no, I'm going in the towel. I need you to say what I'm saying. I need you to corroborate what I'm saying, because God has touched my mouth and gave me the words. So you need to say what I'm saying. If I say you're going to make it, you can't say I'll never make it. I need you to say what I'm saying so that we can work together. I need you to corroborate my story. And my story is you're blessed. My story is you're saved. My story is you're going to make it. My story is God's going to turn it around. My story is God's going to bless you. But you got to say what I say. And if you don't say what I say, you're wasting my words. And you're wasting my time. All these messages I've preached all these years, in November, it'd be 20 years of preaching. If people don't say what I say, then it does me no good. Well, you're not special. No, I'm not special, except for this next verse. This right shall say what I say to corroborate my story. John 12:49 says this, for I have not spoken of myself. But the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment what I should say and what I should speak. Do you think I just get up here and randomly rush through and pick a message to give you? No, I'm saying what God told me to say. Sometimes he wakes me up and puts it in my head and makes me think about it. And when I get up here and say it, it's not Andre talking, it's God talking. So say what I say, because I'm saying what thus says the Lord. What I'm supposed to say. And you'll know when I'm saying something different, because it won't make a bit of sense. Because Andre by himself, I think all kinds of crazy stuff. But when you hear the power of God, it's because God is talking. So say what I said. All right, I've got 3 minutes and we're going to close here. So we have cooperation, then we have corroboration, and the last thing we have is collaboration. So last thing, I got two verses on this. Now, it was interesting when I was looking at it, I was asking myself and asking God, cooperation and collaboration sound like the same thing. They're similar, but there's something different. In cooperation, the hidden word is operate. So what you have to do is you have to help me operate. You have to help me operate this ministry. I can't do it by myself. You have to help me and we have to cooperate. But the hidden word in collaboration is labor. So the difference between cooperation and cooperation is with. In other words, if me and Sister Ruthie, if we take this pulpit and we move it and put it outside, we cooperated and did it together. But collaboration, you don't have to be in the same room to collaborate. In other words, if me and her are collaborating on a book, I can write in my computer, she can write in her computer, we can be miles apart, but the book is still coming together because we're collaborating. And so what we also need is collaboration. And the reason why is because cooperation, you can do it in church when people are looking at you. But collaboration is what you do when nobody's watching. When nobody is watching, do you still collaborate with what I'm talking about? Do you still pray for what I'm talking about? Or are you doing your own thing, talking about your own stuff? Am I up here preaching one thing, but you won't collaborate at home? When I say God is good, you're over there talking to your kids. You know, Pastor Andre, you get on my nerves. You've got to collaborate with me if this thing is ever going to work. And I'm talking about not in the four walls of the building. I'm saying when you're gone, you got to work with me.
Amen.
Pastor, how can I work with you? Read your Bible. Pray. Love on people. I want you to help me so that we can move this thing forward.
Amen.
I need collaboration. And the last two verses, I got 1 minute, stand to your feet. Last two verses of this. 1 Corinthians 3:9 says this, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. Meaning ye are God's garden.
Yes.
And we are all God's garden and we work together with God. Next verse says this. It says, 1 Corinthians 3:10a, according to the grace of God which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation. I am the wise master builder according to the grace that God has given me, and I start the foundation, but it's up to you to work beyond that and build and grow and cultivate culture. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for that which you have spoken for me, God. Help us to cultivate culture in such a way that we provide a viable alternative to the world, but we're working on ourselves, and we're not working on ourselves because we want you to accept us. You have already accepted us, but we're working on ourselves because you provided it for us. And with your tools, with your word, with your prayer, with your people, God, we're going to be the best possibly can. Yes. And we're going to work together, and when we come together, we're going to make a difference in this city. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. And let everybody say,
Amen.
Amen. Cooperation, collaboration. Say this with me, I will.
I will.